Okay. My name is Alex Izquierdo. I am the Business Development Officer, Bank at Work Division for Associated Bank. And over here to my right is Christine Mitchell. She is the branch manager for our Portage branch. I have 10 years of banking experience, and if you want to share.
And I've been in banking about 20 years, so altogether, with several different financials, and I've been here at Associated for a few years now.
So once again, and also thank you for this opportunity to present on identity theft. This is one of the topics that we discuss in our financial education series. So we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about tips to avoid identity theft, what you should do if you become a victim of identity theft, how to obtain free copies of your credit report, and then the one thing about this is that I don't want to stand up here and just information dump. That's the last thing that I want to do, because these are made for, if you all have any questions, raise your hand and we'll try to answer your questions as best as we can.
And also, if you do have any questions that maybe you don't want to ask out loud in the forum, I'm more than happy after we're done here to answer any questions or help you with anything that you might want to ask privately.
You all should have received Christine's business card. If you don't have time to ask the question now because we have limited time, email her. And she can answer your questions that way.
Yep, the business cards are out there, and then my phone number is also on your Bank at Work packet that I believe everyone did receive.
So, does everybody have a packet? All right, good. All right, so tips to avoid identity, well, before we jump into this, I just want to share something, just some information that I found. So, in the last 6 years, $110 billion has been lost to identity theft. Is that a lot of money?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know. And I also wanted to share with you all that the top three areas where identity theft happens is in your taxes, in employment and tax fraud. And the biggest one out there is credit card identity theft. So one thing that the financials have done to kind of protect not only the customers of the credit cards / debit cards, but also the banks and other financials is the chip card. Does everybody have a chip card on their debit card or credit card? So the chip card was created to make it hard for identity thieves to steal somebody's identity, and that because of that, it has reduced identity theft a little bit. But now the biggest thing that they're focusing on is new account openings, like checking accounts, savings accounts, credit cards, and so the information that we post up here is just a little bit to help you all, you know, to just be aware of what's out there. We deal with this stuff every day. We get calls, you know, hey, I think something happened with my checking account, you know, and then at that point, we ask a number of questions to find out, you know, were you in Chicago last night buying $800 worth of hair supplies? You know, that happened to be, you know, I got a call Sunday night, hey, how you doing? How you enjoying those hair supplies? I'm like, what? $800.
So sometimes you'll get a phone call too, you know, from your bank, just questioning those authorizations. And sometimes you're like, really? Or, you know, you might try to go to use your card and you can't use it and you're declined, and it can be kind of annoying. But again, all of those things are protections that, you know, the financial institutions put in place to help you, to protect you, to make sure that it isn't someone else stealing your information.
Yeah.
They go back?
Yeah.
Oh, there you go.
Nope. Wrong one. There you go. So, how many of you have received that call? Hey, I'm looking for James. Oh, James doesn't live here. You have the wrong number. Well, maybe you can help me. Mm-hmm. How many of you engage in that conversation? How many of you hang up? Mm-hmm. Yes, hang up. Mm-hmm. Hang up. You know, I we've been a part of, you know, we've heard it far too many times where, hey, you know, they called and they wanted to know my social security number, and who called you? Well, Associated Bank. No, we don't do that. We have that information already. You know, any financial that calls you, they're going to have that information already. And mainly what they'll do is they'll send you a letter first to let you know something's up. Has anybody ever experienced anything like that, where you get a phone call or you're just like, what? You hang up. No, I see some no's, but I see a lot of this. You know, this might not affect you all, but you know, if you have relatives that are older, you know, my mom, she had her car in the dealership, and they said, you know, I don't know, somehow, some way, they found out that her car was in the dealership, and they're like, you know, your car, the warranty is out on it. And she's like, oh no. And then she like conferenced me, and she's like, Junior, they're gonna send you an email. I'm like, whoa, what are you doing? She's like, well, I gave them my information because I wanna make sure that my car is covered. And I'm like, Mom, what did you do? She's like, well, the car is in the garage, it's in the shop. And I just don't trust it. I'm like, Mom, you just got the car a week ago. It's a 2016, it's fine. She's like, but they said the warrant. I'm like, Mom. So anyways, she was, you know, she was taken for a ride in this. And this is the thing, folks, on average, if you are affected by identity theft, the cost to recover that is about $500 out of your pocket for something that you all didn't start. I don't have $500 laying around, do you all? Should you be a victim of identity theft, report the lost or stolen checks and credit cards to the appropriate financial institution as soon as possible. How many of you have your, how to contact your credit cards and your financial, how many of you have that phone numbers, those phone numbers at hand?
It's on the back of the card.
Yeah. Right, but if you don't have the back of the card, you know, I don't, now I do. But you know, I would. There are, like, if you lost your phone and all your information is on there, you know, if you're able to log into your, if you have Gmail keeps track of all your contacts, and if you have a little area where in your phone where you put notes underneath in the contacts, Gmail will store that information for you. And there are so many places with that'll, you know, they have public computers where you can log into your Gmail and get that information. Or from home, you can do that as well. So if you their checks are stolen, credit cards are stolen, contact the institution right away. Anything you'd like to add?
Yeah, I guess a couple things. We're kind of talking about keeping your information, keeping those phone numbers handy. Also be aware that sometimes there's scams out there where someone will contact you and tell you, generally it's called a Microsoft scam, that they want to access your information. Some people do actually allow them to access their computer, and all of your information then is at risk. So be very leery of that. And don't do that, and spread the word so that, unfortunately, they tend to target generally older individuals, but it happens to a lot of very, very intelligent people. It's really easy to think that, you know, it's legit and they need to update. But again, don't allow anyone access to your computer unless you have initiated the request to them for some reason. And as far as, yeah, the credit cards and your debit cards, either keep it online through Gmail or through a source like that, or also maybe keep it somewhere safe in a paper copy too, isn't a bad idea.
How many of you still mail your payments, checks and stuff? You might want to consider doing an online bill payment. You know, my parents are old school. They don't have any debit cards. They still do everything through checks. So I'm trying to convert them. It's been a 10-year conversion, but you know, they're slowly converting over. And you know, if you still mail it out, make sure that you're dropping it off at the post office or in the mailbox, or make sure that you see your postman taking the mail. I used to run a branch in Madison, and my mailman walked in with a satchel from home, and he was wearing a Hawaiian shirt. And I'm like, you're taking, he was taking our mail, and I'm like, can I see some ID? He goes, oh, I just started. And I'm like, wait, who's your supervisor? Where, you know, where, who do I call in? And I had the gentleman waiting there. I'm that type of person, I'm sorry. You know, I'm not. So I called his supervisor, I'm like, hey, I have, he's wearing a Hawaiian shirt. I'm like, yes, that's it. He's like, that's my guy. I'm like, well, he was, his stuff's being ordered. I'm like, well, a sweatshirt or something, or I mean, maybe even those shorts, you know, with a nice cool hat that they wear. And he's like, yeah, we're all out of that stuff. You know, so don't be afraid to call and, you know, inform yourselves of, you know, of who you're doing business with.
Can I just add too, going into the holidays, if you are putting mail, you know, into bins and things, make sure they're not, you know, overflowing or to the point where someone could maybe access them or get access to any of those mail depositories. Sounds crazy, but it has happened. So, yes, ma'am.
So, are you saying online banking is more secure than a check?
Anytime you write, anytime you write a check, you are handing over your personal information, your account number, your routing number, and what bank you bank with. So keep that in mind. So if you're going through online banking, there's a lot of firewalls and security put in place so that your information is protected. I do feel like it is safer to go ahead and pay through online bill pay if you're paying through your bank's bill pay system and through that security. Now, if you're going and paying bills on each and every site, I don't feel that that's necessarily as secure, obviously, because every time you go into a different site, then you're putting your information in again and again and again, and you're actually probably opening yourself up to more risk. But utilizing the bank's online bill pay is a really good option. Also, if it can't be sent electronically and the check is mailed, it's not your personal check that's mailed, right? So it's a bank check. It has who it goes to, but it doesn't have your account number on it. So, yep, good question. Any other questions on that?
Just to add to that, how many times have you had your neighbor from three blocks down say, hey, I accidentally got your mail? You know, that has happened a lot. I live in a small town, and you know, if your regular mail person goes on vacation, they have a tap doing it, or they have somebody, you know, a fill-in doing that, you know? So try to do things online, and you know, go to, you either do e-statements or get your mail, some of your mail, you can have your mail electronically from, if it's from a department store or a bank. Once a year, obtain a copy of your credit report to ensure. Oh, you gotta get that, go ahead. Okay.
It's her alarm.
Once a year, you know, you are in the state of Wisconsin, you are entitled to one credit report from each of the credit bureaus that are out there. You know, take a look at it, see what's out there. Make sure that the addresses that it shows that you've lived at are correct. Make sure that any of the accounts that show up on there are yours. You know, on there you'll find your date of birth, obviously, where you've lived, your employer, where you've worked. If any of that information is incorrect, reach out to that credit bureau and correct it. Anything you'd like to add?
No, that was good.
Yep. I have a question. Yeah. Some of these credit reports that they put on your, like your MasterCard bills, are those accurate?
Yes. It's just a snapshot of what's out there. You know, it won't, I know Discover does it. My parents love Discover. And then I have to monitor it all the time. You know, but yeah, they are accurate, but all that is like a snapshot. It doesn't tell you what actively is going on. So yes, they do. But like I said, reach out. In your packets, there is an address in there, a website, where you can go and request your credit report from the credit bureau.
Yeah, annualcreditreport.com.
Yeah.
Or the actual.
So on there, you'll see, and I'm gonna, you know, I have a lot of stories because I worked in Madison. I work in Madison. You know, on there you'll see things from like collectors, medical bills. You know, collections from medical. If you have that, that you have that. Another thing, you know, if you have an unpaid parking ticket, sometimes those fall on your credit report. With all the fraud that's going out there, folks, it is. I don't want to say it's super easy for somebody to get your information, but what I want to say it takes you a little bit of your time to find out what's going on with your credit reports. And, you know, always make sure that you know what's going on in your credit history, your credit report. If you find that something on that credit report is wrong, like I said, reach out to them, and they have 30 days to respond to you and get it corrected. You know, if there is fraud on there and something is not yours, they when you dial in, you will talk to a human person. It's not all automated, so just keep that in mind.
I think that so often, or most of us, I would gather, use mobile banking. So again, just keeping an eye on your accounts too, utilizing those tools to make sure that you're not seeing anything that looks odd out there. The quicker that you can catch something, like I said, and sometimes your financials will even catch it for you, but the easier it is to kind of get things pulled back together.
If you have, just to add to that, if you're able to set up alerts on your mobile banking, do that. I have mine set up so that at any time anything, just an odd number comes through, it lets me know. Anytime my account is under $500, it lets me know. I check my account once a day. Is that a lot? No, because I know at the end of the day that's giving me that peace of mind that I know what's going in and out of my checking account.
I do the same thing, and I do set up alerts. Like anytime at our branch here in Portage, I recommend that they set up alerts for everyone that has mobile banking. So again, that you know if something came through that would throw your balance off and it wouldn't make sense to you, that you'd at least get a text alert.
Any questions so far? Okay, and if you don't have your mobile app from your financial, if you don't have it, your bank, they'll walk you through it. They'll help you put it on, and they'll show you how it works. They'll show you the capabilities of it. So don't be afraid to ask for your financial to do that for you, because we do that.
Yep, absolutely.
Before I walk out, before my customer walks out, I make sure that if they do have a smartphone and they want access to their accounts, that they know exactly how it works. It only takes 10 minutes to learn how to use it. You know, and we're always, we're always fielding questions from our customers, whether through emails or through phone calls. So, you know, it's good to have that relationship with your banks and your financials. Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, I have to go to the next one. So just make sure you are tearing up or shredding. Shredders aren't too expensive, right? So shredding sensitive documentation and disposing of them. Honestly, pretty much anything that comes into you with your name and your address on it anymore, it's probably better just to shred it up, because it is personal information that if you just toss it, you know, could be taken and utilized.
How many of you love getting those letters in the mail where it's a check, you've been pre-approved, it says, you know, awesome stuff, right? You know, like Christine said, the shredders right now, because it's the holidays and tax season is upon us. Cyber Monday was just yesterday. Shredders, you know, it's a $30 investment. I would recommend that you all get one, or if your financial has shredders, you know, ask them if you can take there. Just don't take a truckload. You know, we always have a clean your, I forget what it's called. You can bring stuff that needs shredding to us. And we'll
you can just ask it, as long as you don't bring boxes into us. We'll throw it in our security.
I did the mistake of doing that to a gentleman who he had properties here. And he had properties in Arizona. I'm like, hey, we're cleaning house here with the shred stuff. If you have anything that you'd like to bring, he goes, I do. It was he had a small SUV and it was packed. And I couldn't push him away. Luckily we knew when the shredder guy was coming, so we requested another bin, but one entire bin was his. And so just, you know, take advantage of those services. They're free. Also, protect your account information when you're using it. I know there's another spot in here that's going to talk about passwords. You know, use passphrases. You know, don't just use ABC123. You know, make it a little bit harder. You know, passphrases. what do you
utilize numbers and capitals and, you know, mix it up. Yeah, don't use, we all say, oh, I have so many passwords though, but don't use the same password for everything, especially with, well, with anything you have a password with, right? Especially with your financials and your banking information.
All right, tips to avoid identity theft. Ensure your online purchases are secure. Yesterday was Cyber Monday, as I said. How many of you took advantage of Amazon, Walmart, Target? Those are secure for the most part. And I say for the most part because look what happened 2 years ago with Target. Look what happened a few months ago with that credit bureau that got hacked. How many of you had to go to the website to find out if your information might have been, yeah. And what, you know, I was on there and they wanted me to sign that thing saying that I wouldn't sue them, which is kind of odd because it was their mistake or their error. So if you are doing the online shopping, you know, make sure that you're going to a trusted site. And if you don't know that if it's a trusted site, Google it, review it. You know, you'll be surprised how brutally honest consumers are when it comes to businesses. I was at a dealership a few days ago, and I went to their website just to see what, you know, just how they handle their customers. And by the way, they handle their customers very well, but I mean, customers were like, I got screwed over, excuse the language. You know, I got whatever by my salesperson, and his name was this, and he was wearing that, and when I asked him about this, he didn't know how many fingers were on his hand, you know, I mean, they're just mean. But when it comes to protecting yourselves, educate yourselves on this kind of stuff.
All right, and I guess I just add to, generally a good recommendation is if you are buying online, I do recommend utilizing a credit card to purchase online versus your debit card necessarily, because if for some reason it is compromised, through the dispute process, you have the ability to dispute transactions if they're not valid, if they're fraudulent, but it's much easier to handle it coming off a credit card limit versus coming out of your account that you have to pay your mortgage with or your rent with. So that's just kind of a good tip for online purchasing.
And to add to that, if you happen to have your account hacked and it's your main checking account and you need to close it down, this happened to my parents. You know, they got with that thing with their automobile. They had to close their checking account down, but she closed it down a day before they received their Social Security. You know, and in order to hook that up again, to get it to be deposited into another account, takes 30 days for the Social Security Department to fix that. You know, so just be mindful of that as well. And so luckily she had that relationship with her financial where they kept an eye on it and they deposited it into the new account. But, you know, if you are closing out your debit card, make sure that anything that is automatically withdrawn from it gets transferred over to the new card, because that could create headaches for you. I don't like headaches. Anybody here likes headaches? You know, especially during the holidays.
Yeah, and I would say, like, we have a 24-hour customer service associated, so even if it is that situation, you still want, and you know it's compromised, though, you still want to make that phone call. So, you know, or the next morning if your bank doesn't have, or your claim doesn't have 24-hour customer service. So at least make that phone call and explain to them, though, I have a direct deposit coming in and it's coming in at this day. And like you said, oftentimes we can watch for it if we're aware of it, but just have that open communication. But don't not block it because it's coming in, because you would hate for them to kind of run rampant, right, with the rest of your money. So.
Any questions? Any questions? All right, so the next part is about, you know, if you're not receiving your mail, I've heard of people having their mail forwarded to somebody else. You know, when the post office started, it was them doing the forwarding and it wasn't. So make, you know, if you're not receiving your bills, that's one thing you can do, call the post office and find out, hey, is my mail being forwarded anywhere? Two, you know, contact your bank, see if you're still receiving your paper statements. We talk to your financials and say, hey, I didn't receive it, you know, where is it? That's why I said earlier on, I recommend you get these statements if you hack, you know, they're very easy to access. Also, contact the businesses that are sending you the bills, find out if they sent the bill out or not.
And do not carry your social security card, right? Your passport or birth certificate unless you need it that day. So if you're going to the bank and you're going to open an account, you might want to take your social security card with you, but it's not something that you should necessarily, you know, carry in your wallet every day. It says, I believe, right on the card, you know, one, not laminated, right? But two, you know, you don't want to be carrying it with you every day, because if you do lose it, obviously, then it's out there. Or if someone would steal your wallet or take your ID, they would have your driver's license, they would have your credit cards, they would have your social security, they would have everything that they would need to steal your identity.
How many of you remember, you know, when the government, when you could get the little metal plate with your social security number on it and the American flag on it? My grandmother had one of those. And I'm like, Grams, what are you doing? She's like, mijito, son, that's my information. I'm like, hide it, put it away. And, you know, we got her into a safe deposit box, but she was like attached to it because that's something that she felt she got from the U.S. government when she became a citizen. You know, this was like a long time ago. Now it's just a piece of paper, but back then, you know, there was a nice red and white and blue flag on it, and, you know, to her it was a keepsake. And once I convinced her to start using the safe deposit box and just memorizing those numbers, you know, things got a little bit easier for her.
So if you have it in your wallet, take it out, put it somewhere safe, okay? Unless you need it.
What you should do if you become a victim of identity theft, it's real easy to reach out to the credit bureaus and say, hey, I think I've been hacked. They'll put a freeze on it, and with some of them, they'll give you like a freeze pin or a freeze code, and they'll protect you that way. So, for example, let's say I used to work for U.S. Cellular many moons ago, and so we'd call in to get the approved for some live for some lines, and so the customer had a freeze put on it. We had a call in to the credit bureau to have it unfrozen, and they give you a pin that you have to enter, or they would give us a pin that we'd have to enter in order to get them going with their lines. And so it's really secure. Most of it, if you do it, you can call in, like I said, a few buttons and you'll talk to a human person rather than getting stuck on the menus. Also, if you go online to report that something has happened, they'll take care of you that way.
That's pretty much it, I would say, yeah. And if you do believe that you have accounts that, you know, have been compromised, go ahead and close those accounts. Or if you think if they have been opened fraudulently, you find out about it, obviously you can get them closed, right? You can file a complaint with the Federal Trade Commission. You can do that online. And I would also recommend that you file a report with your local police or the police in the community where that fraud may have taken place. They may or may not necessarily do much with it. However, they will have it on file then for a record if there's a trend, and obviously for investigation purposes.
Yeah, that, you know, I used to work in Westfield, and a lady got a letter in the mail from an African prince, and I said to her, I'm like, you know, don't, it's a lie, it's fraud, it's fake. But, you know, I have relatives that have gone there. I'm like, yes, I'm sure you have, but it's fake. I assure you it's fake. I even went as far as Googling it, you know, on and saying, you know, Prince from Africa. And even at that point, she thought, you know, I'm like, look, don't do it. And she even got even more irritated when I said, go see Louis, the chief of police in Westfield, and let him know, oh, I have to go visit that guy. I'm like, yes, because what if somebody else is being targeted? By you sharing that information with the police department, you're making that area or that community aware that this is happening. And then this is the information for the credit report. As you can see in your handouts, all that information is out there. The 800 number is out there. The information for the three credit bureaus, also the website where you can get your free credit reports from the three bureaus is out there. That's it.
Yeah, does anyone have any questions kind of as we're going through the information that you thought of that might be for the good of the group here? Yes.
Are you familiar with the financial management apps like Mint and Every Dollar?
With some of them, there's quite a few.
Information, do you feel like those are safe to use or?
I think for the most part they are. Again, make sure you're dealing with something that's reputable, that you've done some research on, and that, yeah, that you're comfortable with.
There's also that, that program out there, I think it's called LifeLock. Where it's a monthly subscription to that, but it works really, really good. You know, it protects your account, anything involving your social security number, it lets you know right away. It'll either send you a text message or it will call you. There's free programs out there. Do you know any of those free programs?
As far as like she was talking about with protecting
your social security.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. We do have services through the banks also. Your insurance, you might be surprised to verify with your insurance agent too. A lot of times there'll be identity theft protection built into some policies that you might have. But